with NCERT Class 9 Geography. Now, the whole of the NCERT Class 9 Geography is based on Geography of India. We'll be again discussing the same topics what we have covered under Class 7. So, the first chapter here would be size and location. But the basic difference would be the depth of the concepts would be much more in Class 9 as compared to Class 7. Now, starting with the basics and the fundamentals again. Latitude range we have already discussed before, the longitudinal extension we have already talked before. So broadly I can say India lies in the northern hemisphere and the eastern hemisphere. So you have northern hemisphere and eastern hemisphere is the predominant location. Now Tropic of Cancer divides India in nearly two halves. So you have the lower half where you have the tropical type of climate and the upper half which has a kind of temperate type of climate, and this was also used by Stamp to understand the 18 degree isotherm, which was more or less similar to the Tropic of Cancer line, and he tried to explain the two climatic regions in India, the tropical and the temperate. Now, the southernmost point of the Indian Union is known as Indira Point. However, this Indira Point was submerged in 2004 tsunami. The total area is 3.28 square kilometers. Of the total world land area that is available, India accounts for 2.4% of the area. It is the seventh largest country by area. The land boundary is 15,200 kilometers and the coastal boundary, which includes the island, is 7,516 kilometers. Now, if we talk about the population of India, India presently is the second most populous country next to China. So, as per 2011 census, you have China which stands at 1.33 billion and India which stands at 1.17 billion. However, it is forecasted that in 2050, India would cross or surpass China and India's population would be 1.69 billion in comparison to China, which would remain 1.3 billion. Now, by the end of 2011, we had 7 billion human beings on Earth, and this is how it evolved. By the year 1900, it was less than 2 billion, and by 2011, it nearly grew more than three times, and it became 7 billion. Now, moving on from Gujarat, which is the westernmost part, to the easternmost edge of Arunachal Pradesh, you have a time range or a time lag of 2 hours. However, to standardize the time in India, we follow a single time zone, that is the Indian Standard Time Zone, and that is 82.5 degrees east, and it crosses Mirzapur in Uttar Pradesh. India has the longest coastline with the Indian Ocean, and as a result it occupies a kind of very eminent position in Indian Ocean. Also, India is the only country after which you have an ocean being named. So you have Indian Ocean being named after India. So these are some of the key aspects. Now moving on to the map of India. So I have two maps here. The second map tries to explain the latitudinal and the longitudinal extensions that we have already covered in the class 7 geography. Now, you have the extension in kilometers north and south which is given. However, the key aspect here is the line which crosses here, which is the Tropic of Capricorn. So, as you can see, Tropic of Capricorn usually crosses Gujarat, then you have Madhya Pradesh, you have parts of Odisha, West Bengal, then Tripura. So you have these states which fall on the Tropic of Cancer, So you have Tropic of Cancer that runs through in the northern hemisphere, 23.5 degrees north. So you have, it nearly crosses or divides India in two halves, the upper and the lower. So you have the Tropic of Cancer here, then you have the island groups and the three oceans. So you have the Arabian Sea, Bay of Bengal and Indian Ocean. The point where the three oceans meet is known as Kanyakumari or Cape Comorin. That was its old name. So you have Cape Comorin, the old name for Kanyakumari, and it's the point where Arabian Sea, Indian Ocean and Bay of Bengal meet. Then you have the Lakshadweep Island group in Arabian Sea, And you have Andaman and Nicobar Island group in Bay of Bengal. Andaman and Nicobar comprises of two island groups, the Andamans and the Nicobars. The northern ones are the Andamans and the southern ones are the Nicobars. Then you have the capital of Andaman and Nicobar is Port Blair. Then you have Lakshadweep, the capital is Karavati. And both Lakshadweep and Andaman and Nicobar are union territories. Then you have other union territories which are dispersed. So you have Pondicherry and the three territories of Pondicherry, that's the Pondicherry, Karaikal on the eastern side. Then you have union territories on the western side, mainly those are Daman and Diu. Then you have Dadar and Nagar Haveli. Then you have Delhi here. So these are some of the important union territories that you have. At present, you have 29 states and 7 union territories. So the recent state that has been formed is Telangana, separated from Andhra Pradesh. So you have Telangana, which is the newest state recently formed. The three prior states that were formed were Uttarakhand, Chhattisgarh and Jharkhand. So these were the three states that were formed in 2000. Now, why is India's location strategically important? Previously, on a world map, if you see, traveling from Europe to India, this was the only route, or I would say the shortest route. After the discovery of Suez Canal, here, this route decreased by nearly 7,000 kilometers. As a result, trade with India increased with time. However, India has numerous historical ties. So, we start with Upanishads, Ramayans, Panchatantra, which are popular throughout the world. Then you have the Indian numeral system, the decimal system, the concept of zero that India invented was accepted globally even days before when we talk about the historical aspect. And India's spices and muslin were famous. However, India also tried to incorporate ties with foreign countries, and you have sculptures from Greece and domes and minarets from West Asia which were visible in India during that time. Now, as I said, you have 29 states and 7 union territories. The state smallest in area is Goa and the largest in area is Rajasthan. So if we move back on the map, you have Goa, which is the smallest in area, and Rajasthan, which is highest in area. You have Sikkim, which is least populated, and UP, which is most populated state. Again, you have the states which border various nations. So you have Pakistan bordering with Jammu, Kashmir, Punjab, Rajasthan and Gujarat towards the north. Then you have China bordering with Jammu, Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand. Then you have Sikkim and Arunachal Pradesh. You have Nepal, which borders with Bihar, Uttarakhand, UP, Sikkim and West Bengal. You have similarly the other nations which border with the various states of India. The most important of these is Afghanistan, which borders with Jammu and Kashmir in the Pak-occupied Kashmir region, and Myanmar. So other states you can easily remember, but most of you would be confused in the northeastern states. So you have Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland, Manipur and Mizoram, which have boundaries with Myanmar. Now, before 1947, there were two types of state that were common in India. They were either provinces or the princely states. Now, provinces were those states which were governed or which were directly under the British rule. As a result, the Viceroy appointed a British official there, and the province was directly under the control of British administration. However, you had princely states which were ruled locally by the rulers, and they kind of acknowledged the sovereignty of the Britishers in turn for the local autonomy that was granted to the states. So you had the princely state of Junagadh and so on. Now, between India and Sri Lanka, you have Pak state and Gulf of Mannar that exist. Maldives Islands exist further south of Lakshadweep in the Arabian Ocean. And Kanyakumari, as we already said, lies in Tamil Nadu, and it's the region where the three seas meet. So these were the fundamental concepts on the first chapter of NCERT Class 9. We'll be talking more about the Class 9 geography in the further lectures. Have a good day ahead.